affections, and I will rid you out of their bondage, and I will redeem you with a stretched out arm and with great judgments. And I will take you to me for a people, and I will be to you a God. And ye shall know that I am the Lord your God, which bringeth you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. And I will bring you in unto the land concerning the which I did swear to give it to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And I will give it you for an heritage. I am the Lord. And Moses spake so unto the children of Israel. But they hearkened not unto Moses for anguish of spirit and for cruel bondage. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Go in, speak unto Pharaoh, king of Egypt, that he let the children of Israel go out of his land. And Moses spake before the Lord, saying, Behold, the children of Israel have not hearkened unto me. How then shall Pharaoh hear me, who am of uncircumcised lips? And the Lord spake unto Moses and unto Aaron, and gave them a charge unto the children of Israel, and unto Pharaoh, king of Egypt, to bring the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. These be the heads of their fathers' houses, the sons of Reuben, the firstborn of Israel, Hanok and Palu, Hezron and Carmi. These be the families of Reuben. And the sons of Simeon, Jemuel and Jamin, and Ohad and Jechin, and Zohar and Shaul, the son of a Canaanitish woman. These are the families of Simeon. And these are the names of the sons of Levi, according to their generations, Gershon and Kohath and Merari. And the years of the life of Levi were 137 years. The sons of Gershon, Libni and Shimei, according to their families. And the sons of Kohath, Amram and Izhar and Hebron and Uzziah. And the years of the life of Kohath were 133 years. And the sons of Merari, Mahalai and Mushai. These are the families of Levi according to their generations. And Amram took him Jochebed, his father's sister, to wife, and she bare him Aaron and Moses. And the years of the life of Amram were 137 years. And the sons of Izhar, Korah, and Nepher, and Zechariah. And the sons of Uzziah, Mishael, and Elzaphan, and Zithri. And Moses took him Elisheba, daughter of Aminadab, sister of Nashon, to wife. And she bare him Nadab and Abihu, Eleazar and Ithamar. And the sons of Korah, Asaiah and Elkanah and Abiasaph. These are the families of the Korahites. And Eleazar, Aaron's son, took him one of the daughters of Putiel to wife. And she bare him Phinehas. These are the heads of the fathers of the Levites according to their families. These are that Aaron and Moses to whom the Lord said, Bring out the children of Israel from the land of Egypt according to their armies. These are they which spake to Pharaoh, king of Egypt, to bring out the children of Israel from Egypt. These are that Aaron, and that Moses and Aaron. And it came to pass on the day when the Lord spoke unto Moses in the land of Egypt, that the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, I am the Lord. Speak thou unto Pharaoh, king of Egypt, all that I say unto thee. And Moses said before the Lord, Behold, I am of uncircumcised lips, and how shall Pharaoh hearken unto me? If we believe that this same God is a deliverer today, shout, I believe. Shout, I believe. God said it, we believe it. That settles it. Amen.
My goings. And he put a new song in my mouth. Anybody got a devil is grabbing us to steal our hallelujah.
Praise, man. You have a praise. Look at someone and say, you have a praise. Hallelujah.
I got almost said that.
Tell somebody. bless you. You may be seated in the presence. Take this opportunity to greet our national overseer, Bishop Franklin M. Ferguson, and his wife, Minister Covina, our General Presbyter Emeritus, Bishop Rice Thompson, and his wife, who are my parents. God bless you. To our senior pastor, Bishop Hewlin A. Hannah Sr., and his wife, and also to all of the bishops who are here present, including Bishop Cephas Ferguson and Minister Anna May, along with Bishop William Ferguson and his wife, Bishop Nathaniel Benamy and his wife, and the wife of our former national overseer, Bishop Elgani Raming, and his wife, Minister Jacqueline, to my precious wife, Sister Bernie, and my family, who have been praying for me, and to all of you, the wonderful people of God, I greet you today in the precious name of Jesus Christ. We also extend special greetings to our guests here, Mr. Reese Chipman, and your family and delegation along with you. May the Lord bless you richly. Just on yesterday, my wife and I, we had a sort of back and forth where she was singing Hallelujah Belongs to You, and I came around the corner heading to the kitchen with the same song, My Hallelujah Belongs to You. And I am just so overjoyed to say that my hallelujah belongs to the Lord. Now there's nobody else that's gonna get my hallelujah, but my hallelujah belongs to the Lord, because He deserves it. He alone deserves our praise. And I give Him all the honor and I give Him all the glory. My hallelujah belongs to You. Amen. Our theme today is, the Lord will bring you out. Why don't you just lean over to your neighbor and tell your neighbor, the Lord will bring you out. Now I realize that you just said that because I asked you to say that. But now I want you to tell them with an understanding that you believe the Lord will bring you out. Tell them again. Amen. We want to encourage one another, you know. Tell one another the Lord will bring you out. Don't take that phrase for granted. A lot of us, most of us, I might as well say all of us, we're going through some things. We've experienced some things. We're facing some things. And we need to be encouraged by our brothers and sisters. The Lord will bring you out. That's all I came to do today, was to encourage you and to encourage us to know that the Lord will bring you out. All right then, the enemy saying, I've been there too long. I've been causing too much pain and trouble. But I believe without a shadow of doubt that the God I serve is well able to bring me out and to bring you out. I'm going to read just a portion of the scriptural text that was read, just for emphasis, from Exodus chapter 6. Then the Lord said unto Moses, Now shalt thou see what I will do to Pharaoh. For with a strong hand shall he let them go, and with a strong hand shall he drive them out of his land. God spake unto Moses and said unto him, I am the Lord. And I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob by the name of God Almighty. was I not known to them. And I have also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, the land of their pilgrimage, wherein they were strangers. And I have also heard the groaning of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians keep in bondage, and I have remembered my covenant. Wherefore say unto the children of Israel, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians, and I will rid you out of their bondage, and I will redeem you with a stretched out arm and with great judgments. And I will take you to me for a people, and I will be to you a God. Ye shall know that I am the Lord your God, which bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. And I will bring you in unto the land concerning which I did swear to give it to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And I will give it to you for an heritage. I am the Lord. This portion of our text is a response by God to the discouragement Moses was facing as a result of following God's instructions to tell Pharaoh, let my people go. Now, isn't that interesting? You doing the will of the Lord, and discouragement is right there. It says in Exodus 5:22-23, Moses returned to the Lord and said, why, Lord, have you brought trouble on this people? Is this why you sent me? Ever since I went to Pharaoh to speak in your name, he has brought trouble on this people, and you have not rescued your people at all. This is Moses' state of discouragement. He did the will of the Lord, and the Lord, it seems, did not rescue. So God responds to Moses in verse 3 of our text and says, previously I was known by the name of God Almighty, but now, you will know another aspect of NIV. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the spirit, and the spirit which is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. So the Lord, but today, my brothers and sisters,
teens,
singles, the married, divorced, separated, widowed, those who have children, those who want children, those who have lost children, those who've been abandoned, those who've been left hanging, those who have lost their jobs, those who have been lied to and been turned around more than once, those who have been cheated, robbed, real problem and a real situation you're facing. You know the kind you can't tell nobody. How much else you got them kind you can't tell nobody? The Lord has a blessing waiting upon you. You are a blessed people. You chosen by God. Don't let anybody tell you otherwise. You have great access to God. All you gotta do is trust Him and praise Him. And know within your heart that He's gonna bring you out of whatever that situation is that has you tied down or bound or shackled. The Israelites were facing a tremendous challenge, having been enslaved under Egyptian bondage. And it seemed like it would never end. Yes, they believed in God. Yes, they knew that they were God's people. They had developed a great disconnect that God would actually be concerned about their individual situation. They daily saw the oppressors flourishing in freedom and abundance. So you can imagine the question was placed by that same master, discourager, and trickster. Why, Adam? Your God doesn't think you are important. You sit down, you're suffering all this time. People laughing at you. You call it on this God. Who cares? To hear you, you ain't important to Him. You're not God's priority. Your God doesn't care what you are going through. The Israelites were so affected by their oppressive circumstances that they would not even listen to the voice of deliverance. The ninth verse of our text in Exodus 6 says, from the NIV, "But they did not listen to Him," speaking about Moses, "because of their discouragement and harsh labor." So the song comes to my mind, does Jesus care? When my heart is pained too deeply for mirth or song, as the burdens press and the cares distress, and the way grows weary and long. Does Jesus care when I've tried and failed to resist some temptation strong? When for my deep grief there is no relief, though my tears flow all the night long? Oh yes, He cares. I know He cares. His heart is touched. Instead, we ought to repeat the word of victory and deliverance and hear the word of the Lord that it may sink into our minds and into our hearts and into our spirit. If it wasn't important to hear the voice of deliverance, God would not have instructed Moses in verse 6 to say unto the children of Israel. Too often, we have allowed the situations we see and the circumstances we are experiencing to entice us into closing our ears to the very voice of deliverance from the Word of God. But today, we together, as a people and as a congregation of believers, we come and declare that Jehovah is His name. We are going to step up to the challenge. We are going